Begin the second session. The pleasure of introducing Dr. Oksana Pelenska, who is an independent researcher on the history of Ukrainian art. She received her doctorate from Lviv State University and currently resides in the beautiful city of Prague, where she is examining the Ukrainian tradition and collections there.
Good afternoon to all of you. My task is here to present Ukrainian artistic life in Prague between two world wars. Unfortunately, I suppose because of my experience that this period is mostly unknown, so I'll try to make my best to introduce this part of Ukrainian modernism in Czechoslovakia. In Czech traditionally closed enough artistic community in 1910s, 30s, Ukrainian modernism experimentation of foreign artists in at all stayed without support. Foreign art groups generally very often were not mentioned by Czechs. This specific line was formed during years by traditions of national art in Czechoslovakia. Main events in Czech art processes in the beginning of the 20th century confirm this idea. First example, please. In 19, we have here cover of this catalog. In 1914, the Prague Czech Art Society Manes opened the big exhibition and the first one of the modern art. There were presented works of four European artists, Brancusi from Romania, Duchamp from France, Gonzalez from Spain, and Ukrainian Alexander Arhipenko. Arhipenko had in Prague, here's this page, five works. Four of them were gypsum and one wooden. These were Swimming Woman, Studio, Woman Under Umbrella, Lying Woman, and one wooden sculpture named Modrano Circus. This one I'll show you now. Oh, sorry. And the author of the exhibition and as well of this catalog, Alexandre Mercado, did not date sculptures. He only, in the introduction to the catalog, wrote that all works are new because they represented new cubism art in Europe. I tried to find reviews, reflections, any articles or opinions about this exhibition in Prague, in Czech artistic journals or in the newspapers, but without any results. So we do not know how popular this exhibition was in Prague, how it inspired local artists, and how strong impact made cubism forms, for example, of Arhipenko on Ukrainian and Czech artistic life. It's a paradox because at the same time, Czechoslovakia opened very for the immigrants from a former Russian empire. Ukrainian society was very large. At the beginning of the 20th century, it was more than 25,000 Ukrainian immigrants and, of course, very large group of Ukrainian artists. Among the first who came to Prague, it was Ivan Kulets. It's his self-portrait done in his earlier Polish period in 1910. He also, as many others, was looking for a dialogue. To look for a dialogue is the characteristic made by Professor Mudrak. She underlined then that in Prague, Kulets was looking for a professional dialogue, but without visible results. So he was looking for, he was disappointed and was looking what to do in this situation. No professional support from the side of Ukrainian artists living in Czechoslovakia, in Prague, first of all, of course, and among Czech artists. Czech had very good form system of artistic schooling in Prague, in high state and private schools and studios, with its methodological and theoretical strategy. It is very important to realize that Kulets was the first among the Ukrainian artists in Czechoslovakia who used advantages of this tradition for needs of national art. in a good cause to help Ukrainian artists in Prague, he in 1923 founded the Ukrainian Studio of Plastic Arts, named by shortly by Czechs as Ukrainian Academy. First director of studio, Dmytro Antonovic, formulated the concept of schooling of this school in such way. Studio has to help young Ukrainian artists abroad in their aspirations, therefore it could not limit them by any specific trend in arts. It's very important because the professors gathered under one roof were very different. First of all, of course, the professor of painting, Kulets. The second invited by the director, Antonovich, was Sergei Mako, who came from Nice, where he has his own studio. It was also Mozalevsky, student of Miris Kusnik, Ivan Belibin, also Robert Lisovsky, together with, came from Berlin Art Academy, and also Mozalevsky and Kost Stachowski. Among the first Ukrainian students who students of Ukrainian Academy in Prague was Vasil Kasyan, later student of Max Schwabinski in Prague Academy of Arts. Viktor Cimbel came to Prague 1 year later, it means in 1924, and also studied in the Ukrainian Art Academy. And at the same time, he was a student of a Prague art decorative, very highly professional art decorative school. I will try to show you the composition by done in Prague period of him, dated in 1923. Unfortunately, I was looking for the works as well of Kasyan, only two works in the collection of Prague Slavic Library. I was looking also for other works of Cimbel in Czech museums, also without any results. Only one work of Cimbel was found in also in the Slavic Library, is the cover to the children's Svit Detene from 1926. Vasil Khmelyuk is one more student of Ukrainian Academy in Prague. Khmelyuk opened new reality in this city through his poetry. Alexander Fedoruk, a researcher from Kiev, emphasized that Khmelyuk slammed by his poetry like by doors. Khmelyuk futurist, softly erotic, three poetic volumes were written in Prague. And also is the Slavic Library in Prague who has original of all these three volumes. Я прийшов на світ, щоб вступити йому в хитре око. It's the example of his poetry was very good heard in Kiev, in Lviv, in Paris even, but not in Prague, where this poetry was done. Also in this collection, the collection of Slavic Library in Prague, I found the covers and original these books from Khmelyuk. Three of them, the first, Hin, it's very difficult to translate, chasing or something like this. Another, the second one was 3 years, 3 days, 1926, 28 and 23, written and published in 1928. And the last one is Osinje Sonce, Autumn Sun, published in Prague, also didn't have no practically no popularity in Prague. Khmelyuk's friend and excellent graphic, HURI Wolfk, is the cover made, the previous one made by HURI Wolfk, friend and very good graphic working in Prague. And the last one is the work of Vasil Khmelyuk. Also, I'll show you how he illustrated this, the last third Prague volume of his poetry. In 1928, Chmeliuk also left Prague, like many others, as Petro Omelchenko, Mykola Krzyzewski, Sofia Zaritska, Petro Holodny Junior, and other of them, and mostly they graduated Ukrainian Academy. Their departure, however, was not visible in the artistic life in Prague. Ukrainian artists in Czechoslovakia who lost their mother country went from realism of the end of the 19th century to the culture of the Czech postmodernism of the 20s, ignoring even their genius in Prague, Alexander Archipenko. Some of them, however, showed their interest. I will show later, possibly because we do not have time, what pictures and how many artists were influenced by Archipenko in Prague, but it was not the experiment, it ideologically motivated modernism. It was only the way to search new expression in art. Very interesting in this case, I suppose, is the experience of Sergei Mako, who tried, the professor of Ukrainian Academy, who tried together under one roof the Slavic artist who lived in Prague on the base of the Russian Euro-Asiatic idea. In 1929, he founded the group who was named Skiffy. Blog is very popular here. And the members of this group were very good known artists. Nikolai Regionov, Mykola Glushchenko, Mako, Nadia Bilecka, Alexander Orlov, by the way, Russian artist who graduated Ukrainian Academy of or Ukrainian Studio in Prague, Grigory Musatov, Yuri Vovk. But they have two exhibitions in 1931, the first one, and 1932, the second and the last. The group Skiffy was without any support, any attention from the side, as well from Czechs, as well from Ukrainians. Czechs tolerated this experiment, I mean Markov's, but the main sense of the dialogue, Ukrainian modernism versus Czech tradition, remained inviolate. The very, I suppose, brilliant here is example, the exhibition of Alexander Archipenko in Prague. He was invited to Prague in 1923 by the very popular in this time Czech association Devětsil. Devětsil, to press exactly translation from Czech, means nine powers, but at the same time is the flower medicine tea who gives strength, new energy, and so on. So this name means that the ideology of this group and the founder of this group was Karel Taiger. It's very important to underline this because Taiger was their flag, their main person who said that we must do everything to show new proletarian art, and always and all powers are good for this. This group invited personally Taiger, invited Archipenko to Prague in 1923. These are works which I will try to show you later because I haven't time. Here is when I was looking for a catalog for some pieces or facts to support what was, how was supported, or what was the opinion of Czechs to Archipenko. I was in the archive of the National Gallery in Prague, and I was lucky to find there three letters by Alexander Archipenko. Nobody knows about them till this time, so I now, it's my first presentation of these letters in this conference. Two letters were written before the exhibition opened. It means in the beginning of the April 1923. They are in French. The last one was written by Archipenko in German, sent from Berlin in July 23. Mostly they are dedicated to how to move, to go through the border, how to pay taxes, and so on. But very interesting is the letter from the 4th of April, 1923, where, written in French, where Archipenko wrote, "My works, which I am sending you, are different. They are sculptures, realistic and abstract. I am not an artist who is on the way of experiment of art. I am not revolutionary, not reactionist. I am searching innovation that to solve plastic problems of my time inspired by my feelings." He has in Prague 32 works. Here is the cover of catalog done, and as well as the exhibition by Karel Taige. Karel Taige, in his introduction, named Archipenko the artist who first was able to push sculpture of the 20th century from stagnation. However, no state museum or private association did not buy any of Archipenko's works. There were no appropriate publicity in press. I was looking to all journals and as well newspapers of that time. I was looking in Czech publications as well in Ukrainian. And it is very important to underline that Ukrainians have very many and very high professional journals, artistic even, including in Prague. Nobody except one article which I have found in a Czech journal named Stavba, Building, and also written by Karel Taige. It's, I should say, angry article by Taige in this journal where he wrote, "We have two possibilities to realize, thankfully, that a few works were sold to private collectors, and these masterpieces remained in Prague, but state and modern galleries ignored opportunity to make successful acquisitions. So I was looking where these works are, and I was lucky in my investigation because this is one piece from the private collection. I do not, unfortunately, know who has it. Here is the article the letter by Taige where he was discussing some taxes problems with Archipenko. And here is the work who was bought from the private collection to the National Gallery in Prague. So today we know that two works of Archipenko date, it's marble, are in the exhibition of the new exhibition of the National Gallery, Artists of 20th and 21st Century. The third previous is in the private collection. One was as a gift from Archipenko to one person, but I do not know till now, unfortunately. I'm looking this person. It was a collage, named only in the paper, collage. And the fourth is in my investigation is in a private collection in Karlovy Vary. But nobody knows. I was speaking with Czech museum workers. They do not know what does it mean, composition. Possibly I'll be lucky and something will be known in future. So, pardon me? Yeah, I'm going to the end. Also unhappy in Prague was Exter, Alexandra Exter. He has very good and very nice exhibition in Prague in the very popular museum, Art Decorative Arts, in 1937. No one museum have bought no one work to Czech collections. So we can say that she was unhappy, as well as Archipenko in Czechoslovakia. And as conclusion, modernism, Ukrainian modernism, is the same time in Czech Republic is the time of making statehood. and aesthetic principle and ideology of modernism among Czech artists were inspired by historical reality. Probably this fact could be an answer why traditional national mentality of Czechs delayed modernism trends, very popular in the West. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me just jump in for a minute because it's very, very curious why the Czechs would have reacted in this way. And I wonder, well, there are a couple of things I wonder about. One, the political situation. It's precisely after World War I that we actually get the formation of Czechoslovakia. So there is a whole look inward to finding their own identity. And I wonder if this has anything to do with their pushing out everyone else's identity so as not to in any way what contaminate what is really Czech. And secondly, what about the linguistic interaction? When the Ukrainians first came to Czechoslovakia, to the new Czechoslovakia, what language could they communicate in? They had Ukrainian. Did any of them speak Czech? Did any of them speak?
They studied and began to speak very quickly.
Very quickly?
Yeah.
Okay,
I know that, for example, Czech poets, poet Alexander Oles was fluently speaking Czech, as well as Betinsky, as well as Halina Mazepa, for example, because these examples I can show more. I suppose it's not. Can I speak Ukraine my own? Я думаю, що мовна проблема, вона, можливо, існувала лише на самому початку. І дуже я цілком підтримую, і я згідна з паном доктором Флаєром. Звичайно, чехи в 18-му році перше дістали свою незалежність після трьох століть гніту під Австро-Угорщиною.
I think the problem of the language existed at the initial stages of the period, and I completely agree with the comment of Michael Flyer. Of course, in 1918, the Czechs won their independence.
Я думаю, що це є основна причина, і чехи шукали своє власне вираження. Вони мали дуже добре розбудовану мистецьку школу, і, звичайно, вони не хотіли допустити чужинецьких впливів на свою систему освіти.
And the Czechs were in the process of looking for their own self-expression. They had their highly developed national artistic school, and they would not allow foreigners to interfere with it.
Of course, it's very interesting to show this group of Skiffy. Here is their leader of Marka. Very interesting because, unfortunately, it's only black and white because the reproductions in the catalog of this time are black and white. Title is here the portrait only. Then I'll show you the other one. It's a very interesting work made by Herkin-Rusova, Natalia Herkin-Rusova. The composition with the fan, 1923 also. I suppose that, мені здається, що після виставки, особливо 23-го року, в Архипенка у Празі, багато хто під цей вплив потрапив. Вони робили ці роботи, тому що інакше вони не могли появитися ці роботи, чи, наприклад, Михалевича «Дві жінки».
I think that after the Archipenko exhibit of 1923 in Prague, a lot of people got under his influence. Otherwise, they wouldn't be able to come up with something of this nature. This is a work by
Михалевич,
two women.
Переважно вони працювали під... Це не був ідеологічно виношений модернізм, чи в даному випадку мистецтво кубізму. Це був лише пошук своєї мови, висловлення, потреба говорити інакше. Але...
It was not an ideologically thought through modernism as a kind of finished concept. It was in this particular case we're talking about cubism. It was a process of search and at the same time a desire to find one's self expression.
Наприклад, це портрет Юрія Вовка, портрет Олександра Орлова. його колеги по українській студії.
For example, this is a portrait by Yuri Vovk of his colleague in the modernist studio, Alexander Orlov.
Так. And here is Olga Rusova. Portrait, I suppose it's Alexander Oles. I have showed this portrait to many others, and they agree that possibly it's the artistic view of a famous Ukrainian representative of the Prague poetry school, poetical school. Here is, I suppose also, this is a portrait of the husband of Volodymyr Koval, done by Halina Mazepa in Prague. I suppose that, of course, this portrait can't be born without what she can see in the exhibition of Archipenko, because Czechs in the same period, Czechi в цей самий період, навіть якщо говорити про дев'ять сил, they do not love. Вони не дуже любили дев'ять сил, цю організацію мистецьку, тому що вона була надто пролетарською.
The Czechs themselves, if we are talking, we were to talk about this specific period, the Czech public were not terribly enamored with the works of this group, the Nine Forces, because they considered it to be too proletarian.
Звичайно, коли про це говорив 20-й рік, а Чеська Чехословаччина народилась у 18-му. Надто швидко говорити про пролетарські ідеї.
And it's too soon to talk of proletarian ideas, given the fact that we are in 1920 and the Czechoslovakia came around in 1918.
Можливо, комусь здається, що справді українські митці у Празі перестрибнули з кінця з реалізму кінця 19 століття до авангардного мистецтва початку 20-го і ігнорували при тому те, що діялося навколо них. Але при цьому не треба забувати, що вони пережили і з чим вони прийшли до Чехословаччини.
To many it may seem like Ukrainian artists living in Prague made this huge leap from the realist art of the end of the 19th century to post-vanguard, avant-garde art of the 1920s, but we need to take into account what their personal experience, what they went through.
Вони дістали те, що називалося величезне соціальне замовлення. Треба було видавати газети, публікувати книжки, навчати в школах, були вищі заклади навчальні.
They got what can be called a huge social commission, publishing books, thinking of setting up schools for children and things of that sort.
Видавалося, якщо розкласти на день, то приблизно видавалося, я маю на увазі період від 1918 до 48-го року, отих 30 років. Якщо розкласти на день, то приблизно десь 500-600 витисків друкованої продукції кожного дня. Це колосальна робота, яка, звичайно, у художників брала великий час. І вони її робили дуже, треба віддати належне, надзвичайно високим, на високому професійному рівні.
So if you take the period of 30 years, more or less, between 1918-1948, and distribute the amount of off-prints that were produced, we're talking about 500-600 off-prints a day, which is a huge amount of work.
Мені здається, в цьому треба шукати відповідь на запитання, чому і українська громада не віддала належної уваги своєму генієві.
I think it's a legitimate question to pose why the Ukrainian community itself did not value their own genius in a proper kind of manner.
Можливо, в даному випадку Карл Тайгез прислужився не хотячи з мінусом, тому що, власне, якщо б не дев'ять сил його запросило, я маю на увазі Архіпенка до Праги, таке надзвичайно пролетарське нове об'єднання, можливо, це було б інакше. Проігнорували дев'ять сил, проігнорували Чехи, Це саме зробили українці.
Perhaps Carl Tiger unwillingly offered him a bad favor, because if it were a different artistic organization that invited Archipenko other than the nine forces that were ignored by the Czechs, maybe he would have fared better.
You mean not unwillingly, but unwittingly?
Unwittingly.
Yeah.
Unintentionally.
Спасибо большое за интересное сообщение. У меня несколько вопросов. Во-первых, почему вы говорите о том, что Девять сил так отталкивал от себя своей пролетарской платформы? Это ведь было в самом начале, только в первом номере практически журнала. А потом конструктивизм, чешский поэтизм, сюрреализм – это все выросло из Девять силы. И он буквально через несколько месяцев перестал следовать своей программе.
Well, I have a number of questions. Number one, why do you say that the nine forces were universally rejected by others? It was the problem initially for what they were doing. Later on, they very quickly became attractive, and that was the group from which such things as Czech constructivism, paratism, and surrealism sprung.
И Тайге перестал следовать этой такой пролетарской программе. Тут, мне кажется, причина, наверное, в другом, что это была исключительно чешская организация, как бы не нуждавшаяся в художниках другой национальности, мне так кажется. Ну и как бы эстетические платформы художников, о которых вы говорили, мне кажется, они не соответствовали Девять силу. Это мое мнение.
I think the real reason was that the Nine Forces were essentially a Czech organization, having no necessity in representatives of other cultures.
А второй момент. У вас мелькнула картинка Андреенко, но вы не сказали о том, что все-таки он в Праге поставил три спектакля. И сохранились эти эскизы в архиве Национального театра. Вот я сам в руках держал эскизы к «Недоросли». Другое дело, что в этих эскизах он не предстает как украинский художник, а скорее как представитель русской сценографии. Ну, как бы, но эти спектакли имели резонанс и сопровождались большой прессой.
And there was I caught a glimpse of a reproduction by Andreenko, who, by the way, produced three plays in Prague, and he designed this. He did the stage design, and in my opinion, he comes across not so much as a Ukrainian stage designer, but as a Russian one.
И третий, вы упомянули выставку Экстер 37 года. Действительно, в Умпроме это была выставка, и вы, наверное, пользовались тем же каталогом, что и я в библиотеке Умпрома, да? Вот там, это была выставка продажа, и там отмечены проданные вещи Экстер. Не пытались ли вы найти? Там есть несколько... Эта выставка была как бы парижского творчества. Экстер в основном театральный. Что-то там как бы существовало в тиражных виде, а что-то было, несколько работ были проданы, вот, которые как бы мы не можем идентифицировать сейчас, что это, потому что в каталоге там две или три черно-белых картинки. Не пытались ли вы разыскать эти работы? Потому что вот одна была, я ее нашел, это была коллекция Милчи Майеры, бывшая, и она в доме у ее наследников есть. А вот остальные, это просто вопрос.
And also you mentioned the 1937 exhibit of Alexandra Exter, basically of her works that were created in Paris, and it appears that both you and I use the same sources, and we're talking about an exhibit that was organized with the purpose of selling her works, and some of the works are marked off as having been sold, and I was able to establish that at least one work was sold to a private collection. Did you try to follow up and research on other works, where they ended up?
Благодарю вас за вопросы, они очень интересны, и у меня сейчас будет возможность немножечко расширить эту тему. Вначале о «Девять сил». «Девять сил» имела несколько отделений: поэтическое, театрального искусства, графики и живописи. Заниматься или следить за этим было очень сложно. Это не было заданием тех сил, которые, творческих, украинских, которые были. Они просто автоматически это отмели, поставили в сторону, и на этом этот диалог закончился. Они не разбирались. Для них был Карел Тайге был рупором, скажем, в первую очередь, ну, скажем, человека со знаком или творчества со знаком минус. Поэтому действительно, вы правы в том, что там Ярослав Сейфорд, например, блестящий поэт, или художница Тоен. Но Тоен, она немножечко позже, это творчество развивалось, но оно было очень контроверсивно, потому что выставка, которая была 5 лет назад в Праге, огромная выставка Тоен, она все равно, на ней не была поставлена точка в отношении того, как рассматривать ее в русле 9 сил. Но это действительно немножечко другое, потому что рассказать нам сегодня о том, как относились 7 лет позже, после 27-м году, они просто уже закрылись, они распались, этого объединения не стало, но никто этим не занимался, ни художники, которые были в самом центре украинской творческой жизни.
The issue of this artistic group 9 forces is a very complicated one, and the fact is that it was not a simple phenomenon. The group consisted of a number of subdivisions. There was a poetic division in the group, or subgrouping. There was also theater design, graphic, painting. But the thing is that they were rejected. Nobody had time to figure out what they were about. The attitude towards them was kind of rejection at the very initial stage. And as far as I understood, the public rejection of it, without going much into what they were about by division, because actually there were these wonderful poets, Yaroslav Safin and others.
В отношении Андриенко не читала, он работал, он с этого и начал, он был всего 3 года неполных, фактически 2 в Праге, он работал в так называемом немецком, русском и чешском национальном театре. Найти декорации или то, что он там делал, просто нету.
В архиве национального театра,
есть.
As far as I know, Andriyenko spent not even full 3 years, and he worked in 3 theaters: the Czech, the so-called Russian, and also the German one. And I was not able to find any of his works. And then there was the comment that his stage design for the play Недоросля is at the National Archives.
И, безусловно, одно, что именно работа театрального художника его инспирировала к коллажам. Первые коллажи были созданы здесь, в Праге, в 1922 году. В 1923 году он уехал.
And it goes without saying that his work as a stage designer also inspired him to start working in collage. And his first collages were made during his Prague period.
И для меня было очень большим удивлением то, что я не нашла ни в одном государственном музее Чешской Республики, в Словакии тоже, ни одной работы этого мастера.
It was a big surprise to me that I was not able to find not a single work by this master in any of the Czech or Slovak state institutions.
И в отношении Александры Экстер, мне очень жаль, но первые мои вопросы, когда я только приехала в Чехословакию, как раз были относительно работ этой художницы тоже. Но, к сожалению, я не получила положительного ответа. Более того, в прошлом году довольно известный чешский исследователь русского ангарда Томаш Гланц издал книжку, которая называется «Лексикон русских авангард». И под гаслом Александра Экстер он даже не написал, не вспоминает о выставке 1937 года, что мне было тоже как-то и немножко удивительно, и странно, потому что это человек, который довольно хорошо сидит в материале, он понимает, о чем он пишет. И тем более, что есть каталог, и можно говорить о уровне творчества и о том, что там было представлено.
The first thing I did when I arrived in Prague was to start tracing Alexandra Exter's works, and much to my regret, I came with no results. And even an influential catalog by the Czech scholar Tomáš Glanc, called entitled "Lexicon Russian Avant-Garde," does not have an entry for Alexandra Exter or has any mention of her 1937 exhibit.
As well as under Alexander Hipinka, no one read about his works in the exhibition 1914-1923.
Okay, I'm afraid the last question will have to be from Shisha Grimstead, then we must go on.
The difficulties of research on the artists and the surviving art of that period, how much do you attribute this, or how much could be attributed to subsequent periods of Nazi or German control during the war, and subsequently during the communist period? Is there any evidence of trying to get rid of some of these materials by either the Germans or during the communist regime? Because I know certainly in the case of books and archives in Prague from emigre communities, they were very seriously repressed during the communist regime. I couldn't even go to the Slovanska Knihova when I came in the 70s. And I just wonder if the fact that a lot of these things were put in wraps later might have some effect on the sources and on your research.
Thank you. How to say, we are at the very beginning to study what Czech collections have now. I mean artistic collection. Because newly founded large collection of Ukrainian arts is the part of the former Ukrainian Museum in Prague, as you know, which was liquidated in 1948. So this collection is something like near 1,000 works. Mostly it's original graphics and very, very interesting works. But also, unfortunately, nobody knows what this collection, how it was formed, what does it mean, how to popular, how to say, what authors were the members of these papers, and so on. And what you have, Germans know. We do not know who was working on this item from both sides, Germans, Czechs, or Ukrainians, before 1989, I mean the independence of and fall of communism regime in Czechoslovakia. Nobody. It was under the, everything was closed.
This really does give a new meaning to the wit who said, as a distortion of the English proverb, that one man's mead is another man's Persian. But we have to end. Thank you very much.
Thank you.